I wanted to start by asking you something at the very beginning of your book that really shocked me. You said the internet is a threat to human civilization. And I saw that and I thought, but the internet is the tool by which you, Julian Assange, have become one of the world's most controversial people, where you've published all this information. Why is the internet bad?
Well, here's the book here as well. It's on the back as well, that quote. But the internet has become integral to our human civilization. It is the device by which we all communicate, by which we formulate laws, by which we engage in trade deals, by which we communicate the very core of our inner personal lives to one another. So the internet and civilization has merged. And that's a new phenomenon. It's not just that this is a phenomenon affecting one country, but rather global civilization is merging, has merged arguably, with the internet. So anything that is affects the internet in a serious way, affects civilization in a serious way. The big problem we have now is the control and mass spying that is occurring on the internet. And that is something that has really shifted and changed in the past 10 years, mainly because the technology to do it has become cheaper.
So let me just ask you a little bit about, I mean, you talk about the cables that obviously are at the center of this entire case in the U.S. In the book. And Bradley Manning, obviously, he's the one who had them, according to the United States. He's in a pretrial hearing. He's trying to get the charges for him against him. They're for aiding the enemy, thrown out of court. But obviously, as I said, he could end up spending the rest of his life in jail. Do you feel any guilt about that, since the information the U.S. government says that he stole was published by you? No matter where you got it, you published it.
Bradley Manning is in court today in the United States and throughout this week. The case is not about whether Bradley Manning allegedly stole cables or not. The case is about the abuse of Bradley Manning. Over a nine-month period, Bradley Manning was abused. In fact, the United Nations has investigated this. The Special Rapporteur for Torture, Juan Mendez, found formally against the United States, saying his treatment was akin to torture. Why was he treated that way? Well, his lawyer argues, and many others who followed the case argues, it was ordered to coerce him into a confession that would bring down me or bring down WikiLeaks. Now, as far as we know, there has been no such confession, but that's the case that's ongoing now. And that case is a reflection of a decay in the rule of law. The secretary, Hillary Clinton's spokesperson, resigned over the issue. The entire Quantico prisoner base in Virginia was closed over this issue. It's a serious issue, and it reflects serious problems within the military system, that it has a feeling of unaccountability, and that unaccountability mm-hmm. is flowing into other parts of our life.
Now, I don't want to get into detail. I know you have a strong point of view, obviously, on how Bradley Manning has been treated, but I didn't want to go down that path. I wanted to ask you a question, though, about something else you said about him when you said that you thought that part of the reason they were doing what they were doing was to coerce him, perhaps, into getting you involved in all of this. He could make a deal to serve limited time. And to make that deal, you could be the guy who loses out. I mean, are you worried that that could be the deal? He says, this is what Julian Assange did to help me get the information to leak it.
Well, I don't want to comment on the legal specifics. That would obviously be unwise in view of what is happening. There's a concurrent process which is occurring for the last 2 years, an ongoing grand jury, which has sucked in a vast number of people, attempted to compel them to testify, pulled in all sorts of records, pulled in Twitter records in relation to information about me, pulled in information from Gmail, pulled in information from American service providers, et cetera, et cetera. So part of the reason that this book has been written is because we have become very well aware of what all these mechanisms are as a result of being embroiled in that process. One of the co-authors, Jacob Applebaum, just filled in for me once at a talk in New York. And as a result, he has been subject to this process as well. He has been detained at airports and so on. You can read about those details in the book. But let's go back to you know, this is just a small symptom. And in a way, what's happening to Julian Assange is not particularly important, except that it is part of a much wider process. Now, it's not just the process that I'm talking about. It's a protest which all the top national security journalists in the United States are talking about. Jane Mayer's article on Bill Binney in The New Yorker says the same thing. Dana Preece from The Washington Post and her book Top Secret America, where she likens what is going on to literally a metastasizing cancer, where we now have 5 million people in the national security clearance system in the United States, state within a state. Now, it's not just the United States. This is a worldwide phenomenon. And you can look at the spy files, which were published by WikiLeaks. Just Google WikiLeaks spy files.
Yep, it's on your website.
And you will see details of over 175 companies around the world that sell this mass surveillance technology. We're not talking anymore about picking on particular activists, going, oh, look, you just spoke to Julian Assange. That's interesting. Now maybe we'll spy on you. Rather, the new game in town is strategic surveillance. It is cheaper now to intercept all communications in and out of a country, store it permanently, than it is to simply go after one particular person. And there's companies in South Africa that were selling that into Libya. The French make a system, Amisys, that we exposed, that was a nationwide interception system, advertised as a nationwide interception system. This is not a matter of speculation. These are documents from these companies. They're secret prospectuses that are sold. Here, strategic mass infection system, FinFisher. Just Google FinFisher, you'll see it. Plenty of good work has been done on this by a whole bunch of journalists.
Right. Now, what I'm curious, though, about this, because, again, this you know, you raise a point. A lot of people share this fear about being under surveillance, right? I mean, I don't, you know, some people might say you go way too far on it, but people do share your fear. But you also are someone out there trying to champion and, like I said, benefiting by the Internet by putting out information that governments don't want people to have. And I wanted to ask you in particular about where you are tonight. First, just one question I wanted to ask you, because people ask me about this today and I have you here and I want to ask you. Officials from Ecuador say that you have a lung infection and you've been sick since you've had to stay there. Is that true?
Well, Julian Assange is not very important. You know, I am in an extraordinary situation, and have been in an extraordinary situation for over 2 years now. But what is important is this development that is affecting all of us. Democracies die behind closed doors.
Can you answer the question about whether you're sick, or do you not want to talk about it?
I don't think it's important.
Okay, then let me ask you this.
Serious situation now.
I understand. Let me ask you this, though, about Ecuador, because, you know, look, as you say, you've been there in this extraordinary situation for 5 months. They've provided you asylum. They've been trying to get you out of the country that you're in right now to avoid facing charges in Sweden or the U.S. But you know, when you talk about this, you know, governments clamping down on people's right to speak, Ecuador is an unlikely champion of your call for free speech. And I wanted to lay this out for you, because just this month, Human Rights Ecuador reports that the president of Ecuador, President Correa, proposed let me finish for my viewers here, though, and then you can go ahead and rip it apart. He said freedom of expression should be a function of the state.
Well, look,
the Committee to Protect Journalists
these little
says,
things about Ecuador or
not,
whatever.
It's Come not on, a little
let's,
thing.
Let's be real.
Suppressing journalists is not a little thing for someone who says that their job is to put out information that governments try to suppress.
It's a very big problem, the suppression of the freedom of speech all over the world, an extremely big problem. And so is the collapse in the rule of law. And you should be well aware that Al Jazeera journalists spent 6 years in Guantanamo Bay, that there are cases all across the U.S., that the Pentagon is now taking a position where it is saying, arbitrarily, completely invented, that the act of receiving information by any journalist anywhere in the world that the Pentagon says is classified and publishing some portion of it or quotes from it is espionage.
Okay,
and they're saying that that is something that applies to journalists and that it also applies to people within government.
I understand your point, but the Committee to Protect Journalists says about Ecuador, that's serious business. Let me ask you the question. About Ecuador, in less than 5 years, President Correa has turned Ecuador into one of the hemisphere's most restrictive nations for the press.
The issue is the
surveillance state. How do you justify staying there as a guest?
We are in a situation where the entire...
I didn't agree to talk about the surveillance state.
We're in a situation... Well, I'm sorry. Look, do you want to bring my PAs on? Please. So, look, let's be honest. We have a serious situation here whatever little things occurring in small countries are not of a concern.
Okay, but this country, Ecuador is the country that is preventing you from being arrested the minute you walk outside the door, including
the United States, including Western Europe, including France, including what was happening in the former Libya. We are experts in this. We have lived through it. We have researched it. We have documented
it. Then why will you not talk about Ecuador?
Of national security journalists who are involved in this sort of thing. Because Ecuador is insignificant.
But it is the country that is enabling you to not be arrested. It's significant.
Its people have been generous to me, etc. Yes. But it's not a significant world player. South America and the developments that are happening in South America are interesting and significant, and it's growing and burgeoning independence. But they are not the topic of what we're doing here. The topic of this book is what is happening to all of us and the threats that all of us face. You know, in the 1930s, certain people saw what was going on, and they saw the general trends. I'm telling you, there is a general trend. I am an expert, and I have lived through it. Other experts have also lived through different facets of this. An American, a German, and a Frenchman, all experts on different parts of what is happening legislatively and what is happening in terms of their technology. Now we are all being intercepted permanently. This is a state change. This is not a matter of simply a small change to any individual. It is a sea change in politics, and we're going to have to do something about it. And if we don't do something about it, we all run the risk of losing the democracy that we've treasured for so long.